I'm sorry, I couldn't hear.
Dion. He's having respiratory, he's got a respiratory infection.
And my sister, her father-in-law passed away. And they're planning the funeral this tomorrow and Friday. And his sister, which is my sister's sister-in-law, collapsed today and she's in hospital. They think.
So pray for your sister's in-law's side of the family. Okay. So definitely sister-in-law collapsed and then father-in-law died. So, yes.
My niece, her son, his father, they're not married anymore.
Okay.
And have been for many years, and his father committed suicide this morning.
Definitely. God knows that need. That's a tough thing. I was just reading that I think men commit suicide at like 4 times the rate of women. And men are going to be meeting on Saturday because we need to address that. And this church needs to address that. So men, please come on Saturday at 8 o'clock and pray in advance for this men's ministry. It's desperately needed.
Just statistically, yes, men, but most of the time it's because women don't succeed, but women are actually more likely to attempt.
Okay. Well, that's true. Succeed and attempt are two different things. That's true.
Women typically do attempt more often than men. So that's,
well,
that's,
we won't get into
that.
Yeah. There's a lot of behind the scenes information there. We won't process all that right now.
And keep the Mitchell family in prayer.
Yes.
Betty passed away Monday.
Right. I'll definitely keep the.
Also, I remembered my friend Chris and John. They're the Australians that came by.
Right.
They're staying with a couple in Tampa right now, and they just had the police come to the door yesterday that her daughter fell. Her daughter passed away, so they're just like, so, her, they're friends. It's Felicia, it's her name. It's their daughter, and she just got noticed that her daughter taken out of bed.
A tragedy. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Let's pray that God would be with our kids as they meet, as well as our study tonight. Let's ask the Lord to be with us. Father, as we come to you, you've heard every single one of the needs. Lord, these that are struggling, these families that are hurting, Lord, I ask that you be with them and help them. Father, I ask that you touch all those that are battling different illnesses, injuries, surgeries that they're facing or recovering from. Father, I pray that you be with each one in Jesus' name. Lord, these that contact us by digital means, Lord, so many of them have desperate needs. And God, you know every single situation. We ask that you meet them in Jesus' name. Father, I ask that you be with the boys and the girls as they meet tonight. Help the teachers as they're teaching them not only practical skills, but Lord, also teaching them more about Jesus, about living for you, Lord. Father, I ask that you'd help us as we think about your return. Jesus, we believe you can come at any time. We're coming up to the Feast of Trumpets, Rosh Hashanah, and it just reminds us that we're waiting for the trumpet to sound, where the dead will rise and those who are alive and remain will join them to be with you, Lord, forever in the skies. And Lord, it's not just pie in the sky, helicopter theology. Lord, it's something that we are aware of, and it causes us to be more diligent to reach our world for you. Father, I ask that you bless this class, and we thank you for doing it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Right this moment, the guys are ahead after Sunday. But my understanding is that the ladies have enough coming in that will be officially counted after today, that they'll be $10 ahead. So guys, you know, need your help to get back ahead again. So just to let you know. A couple of weeks ago, we were unable to meet because of trying to ensure that COVID did not spread through our church. And I did an online study on this. Anybody see it? Okay. Anybody remember what this is called? The Joe Harry window. And it's named after Joe and Harry. Literally.
Not Harry and David.
I think it was Harrington, actually. But anyway, as you look at it, it's kind of interesting to think about how it affects our interpersonal relationships. Okay, how do we understand this? As we view our lives, it's like looking through a four-pane window. Now, this window shows everything equilateral. That's not the way it is. Okay, for instance, this area here is what we know, it's what everybody else knows about us. This is a transparent type, it's known by others, see, and known by self. This area here is an area where we don't see it, we don't know it. It's with things we're blind to. This area here is an area that's unknown by others, but we know it. So we're hiding. We always hide behind a facade. And then there's an area where neither ourselves nor others know. And, you know, it's hidden from both of us. God knows. Now, I'm thinking about Matthew chapter 7, Sermon on the Mount. Jesus is saying about judging, and he says in Matthew 7:3, "Why do you look at the speck that is in your brother's eye, but do not notice the log that is in your own eye? Or how can you say to your brother, 'Let me take the speck out of your eye, and behold, the log is in your own eye'? You hypocrite, first take the log out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to take the speck out of your brother's eye." Well, if we can't see the log in our own eye, then obviously it's in this window, right? Others can see it, but we can't see it. We need somebody to help us. The way that we get help is we ask. Is there something I'm missing? Is there something I'm doing, you know, that you see that I can't see, that others like, "I wish you'd stop doing that," you know. It was kind of funny. At breakfast yesterday morning, Pastor Weshey of the All Saints Lutheran Church was talking about watching an episode of Bob Newhart. You know, he's what, 90 years old? He's still alive as far as I know, unless he died today. Some of you remember he had two shows. One show was about him being a psychiatrist or psychologist or whatever it was. And he decided, as Brother Weshey was saying, that he was going to do a $5 special. For $5, I'll give you 5 minutes. You can tell me all your problems, and then, you know, we'll solve it. And so he tries it on the first woman. First woman said, "Well, this, that, and the other." And he, "Is that it? We still got..." "No, that's it." He said, "Okay, here's the answer. Stop it!" And if it was only that easy, right? But we might ask people and they might help us to find that log in our eye. At the same time, we can be the person helping with that person who may only have a speck in their eye, but we see it, and if they're willing to accept some feedback, then maybe we can help one another. You can help me get the log out of my eye, and I help you get the speck out of your eye. As far as these not being equilateral, I think in another situation, as I showed on the video, this could be a larger area. I think especially if you're an extrovert, you know, that TMI, too much information. No, I'm not even going to tell you what that happened. But anyway. But on the other hand, an introvert, this could be a much smaller area. So you have to decide how much you're going to self-disclose, how much you're going to tell others about that hidden area of your life. You have to make a decision. But as we help one another, these areas, this area is a good thing if it's smaller, this area is a good thing if it's smaller, these might get smaller, this gets bigger, and this gets smaller. So it's just a way of thinking about relating to others. So just a thought, if you didn't see it, you might want to watch. I see it as relating to what I just read here in Matthew chapter 7. And we are called to examine ourselves. It's a good thing to be aware of our behaviors and how they affect others. That's being a good brother or sister in Christ. But we're moving on to what we started last week. I just remembered y'all over here. Who needs a handout? Yeah, you weren't here for some reason. I don't know why you weren't here. Just because you had surgery, you had your arm cut off. No big deal.
I'm getting crucified for that one, too, because you were in the hospital.
Anybody else need one?
I should have been here. My bad. I love you.
That's right. You should have knocked him in the head and came on over. If he's unconscious, you don't have anything to do. Anybody else? Okay. I'm being disturbed. Hopefully you understand. I am a very sarcastic person. I've infected others.
Our family.
Anyway, last week we started on this, and I started the session by asking, when you hear the word rapture, you know, and of course I'm talking about the coming of Jesus Christ for his church, those who are ready for him, you know, what does it make you feel and why? And the results were mostly positive, but there was some concern about lost loved ones. And it's a valid concern. We're wanting Jesus to come back, but we definitely want our loved ones to be saved and ready to go. Amen. So then I also refer back to an article that I had mentioned in February of this year, written by our general superintendent, Reverend Doug Clay. It was entitled Rapture Anxiety or Blessed Hope. And I wanted to encourage us then, I still encourage us, as we look at these scriptures, it's not about getting into technically, you know, exactly when is this going to happen, what's this, you know, what's that about. It's how can these scriptures give us hope. And you remember what biblical hope is, right?
Yes.
When I say the word hope, in a biblical sense, I am not talking about the hope that the world talks about.
Right.
Don't get sick.
They're not.
Okay.
Don't say nothing.
Just keep talking. Our hope is very different because it's a confident expectation based on a solid certainty. How can you have solid certainty?
Trusting in the Lord 100%. Trusting in His Word.
Absolutely. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding, right?
In all thy ways acknowledge Him.
Absolutely. Proverbs.
Yes.
So, trust, faith, they're kind of synonyms. That's the only way you're going to have solid certainty, is by faith. And you know, God has given you some faith, and I believe the Holy Spirit wants to grow that faith. And if every wind of chaos and politics and economic uncertainty causes you to have uncertainty about your hope, then you need to ask the Lord to grow your faith a little bit. But these scriptures are to help our faith grow in what the Lord is going to do. So we are thinking about, first of all, an event that we believe is very close at hand. We have referred to several times and still yet to get there, Daniel's 70th week. We believe that we have passed the 69th week, and we're in between the 69th and the 70th week. We have Daniel chapter 9, verse 24. Sister Cheryl has that.
Are decreed for your people and your holy city to finish transgression, to put an end to sin, to atone for wickedness, to bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal up vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy place.
So these 70 weeks are determined for your people. This is what the angel was telling Daniel, and Daniel's people was Israel. Was the nation of Israel. So Israel is at the very center of this 70-week period of time. And And when we're talking about a week, we're talking about a week of years. And that's been clearly identified in the scriptures. You can keep, continue reading in Daniel 9 from 24 on down. You can see what I'm talking about. In the 69th week, Messiah is going to be revealed and cut off. So Jesus was a preacher for 3.5 years. He was crucified and he rose from the dead. We believe that that ended the 69th week. And we have been in a period of time in between that and the next thing that's going to happen, which is Daniel's 70th week, which we normally call either the tribulation and the great tribulation. It's a 7-year period of time. And but before that happens, we believe that the rapture is going to occur. And we see some of that as we begin to look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 through 18. I gave that to someone to read.
But I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words.
So, if you don't have it, you might want to pull up 1 Thessalonians 4, 13 through 18. Verse 13. According to that verse, what two things is Paul hoping to accomplish through this letter to the Thessalonians? I mean, what he's trying to accomplish in chapter 4, in verse 13. What is he trying to do?
Give them information so they won't be without hope.
So that they are informed instead of uninformed, so that they have an accurate understanding rather than a misunderstanding that might have been communicated by others who didn't have full understanding. So he's trying to convey information. And as you also said, he's trying to give them hope. Hope for those who are asleep. And as we mentioned last week, we're not talking about soul sleep. We don't believe in soul sleep. We believe that when a person dies, in the Bible a lot of times it says that they went to sleep. Like when Jesus was waiting for Lazarus to die, he told his disciples, "Lazarus, our friend Lazarus is sleeping." Well, his disciples thought he was talking about really sleeping. No, I'm talking he's dead. So a lot of times the Bible uses the euphemism sleep for those who die in Christ. Because reality is that when we die in Christ, we go to sleep in this world and we wake up in the presence of the Lord. So it's not like there's this long period of time from the time that our heart stops beating or whatever happens for our death until we're in the... It happens instantaneously. So, but for those who are in Christ, it's like being asleep rather than being in that horrible situation of a hopeless death. And so that's only for those who are in Christ. And I've said it multiple times as a preacher, there's a lot of pressure to preach someone into heaven, whether or not they were ready to go or not. And I don't know that that's actually helping people. And I'm trying to help. I'm not saying, they went straight to hell. I'm going to have to say, if I don't know, they're in the hands of God. God knows. I don't know. I mean, regardless, you know, whether they profess Christ, I don't know. That's, again, up to God. And so the main thing is are we ready? I was talking to Ethan just a minute ago. He said, what are y'all going to be talking about in here tonight? I'm going to be talking about the rapture. I don't know what that is. I said, we believe that Jesus is going to come again. And we need to be ready, because it could happen any time. He says, I'm ready. So that's something that all of us need to take to heart. Be like Ethan. Be ready to go. Because it could happen in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, as we'll read in 1 Corinthians 15. So he wanted to communicate with them and give them hope. He wanted them to be ready. Somebody has Titus 2, 11 through 15. We read this last week, but I think it's good to read it again.
For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in the present age, looking for the blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from every lawless deed and purify for himself his own special people, zealous for good works. Speak these things, exhort and rebuke with all authority. Let no one despise you.
So this is where the phrase blessed hope comes from. In verse number 13, we look forward with hope, or another translation would say to the blessed hope of the return and appearing of Jesus Christ. How do we live in the light of that? Well, we live in hope, obviously, but we don't just sit down and do nothing. We are to be totally committed, as it says in verse 14, to doing good deeds and encouraging others and helping others to get right with God so that they are ready. So Paul was helping those in the Thessalonian church to be informed and to understand what happens to those who die so that they are ready for the return of Christ. So who will participate in the rapture? According to 1 Thessalonians, again, we're back in 13 and 14.
The ones who died who were in Christ.
Okay.
And those who are living in Christ.
Okay. So it may sound like a lot of people, and I guess in relation to how big this church is, it is, but in relation to how populated the world is with 7 billion people, it's really tiny. Who are in Christ. Those who died in Christ are going to far outnumber, I believe, those who are alive in Christ. There's going to be a bigger number of them, but it's going to happen so fast. Those who are dead are going to be with Jesus, and we're going to follow right behind them. It's going to be very difficult to make any distinction that they got there first.
Okay, you know how I like to play devil's advocate sometimes. So, a while ago, you said that, you know, when a person dies, and you know that they are then
they go to be with the in the presence of the Lord, right?
Correct. So why would they have to come back in order to be raised again? Because the dead in Christ shall rise, instead of just staying put where they're at, and then we come.
Right.
So what is the?
Thank you, because I needed to be more specific on what happens when
great.
We die. When we die, we are a tripart being. We have three parts: body, soul, and spirit. And when we die, the spirit and soul doesn't die, only the body dies. So the spirit and soul goes to be with Jesus, but we are not in a resurrected body at that point. And so at the rapture, our bodies are going to be raised from the dead and changed to be like Jesus' body when he was resurrected. A body that has substance and yet has supernatural properties. Can walk through walls, can appear one place and then instantly be somewhere else. And so when that body comes up out of the ground, exactly the timing of that I'm not sure, but our soul and spirit will be reunited with that resurrected body, that body that's like what Jesus has.
Okay, and then where will we be? Will we be on earth as resurrected?
It says we'll meet him in the clouds.
Okay.
Again, there in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, it says, in verse 17, those who are alive and remain, you caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we always be with the Lord. Now, I'm going to get a little ahead of myself. There is thought that after we are raptured, we're going to go to be with the Lord at what is called the marriage supper of the Lamb. And you can read about that in Revelation. Like I said, I'm getting a little ahead of myself. I'm not going to try and get into depth at that point. And then, so for 7 years, we will be feasting with the Lord while very terrible things are happening on the earth. At the end of those 7 years, Jesus is going to come back. That is the day of the Lord. Jesus is going to come riding on a white horse. You can read about it in Revelation 19. And his saints are going to be with him, riding white horses. We don't have to fight. We're primarily just observers, because Jesus takes care of it all. Sword proceeds out of his mouth. He's going to defeat the Antichrist. All of that, you know, the armies that were gathered are going to be destroyed. Blood is going to run through the bridle of horses. We'll connect all that. I'm sorry, it's a lot of information to take in. And then we will rule and reign with Christ on this earth. We believe that he will usher in another period of time called the millennium. 1,000-year reign with Christ. Jesus will rule and reign from Jerusalem, and we who come with him after the marriage supper of the Lamb, we will rule the earth with him. You know, exactly the dimensions of our service to him, which will be a joy, by the way, will depend upon our faithfulness to him on this earth.
Just as you said that, it made me think. When we've gone out of town toward Hiawassee, there's a church that has a sign that they've had on their sign lately, is our duty to serve the Lord. And that is true. But that they kind of make it sound like a drudgery,
right,
instead of a joy.
Right.
I don't know, whether they mean to or not.
It is our responsibility, our duty to serve the Lord. He who has extended grace toward us, shed his blood for us, washed our sins away, certainly we feel an obligation, but at the same time it is a joy to serve the one who died for us, who rose again. It's a joy to be involved in the things that advance the kingdom of God. It's a joy to be with someone and help lead them into a relationship with Jesus Christ. It's a joy to be with a child and help them learn about Jesus and how Jesus can be an important part of their life. A lot of us probably would say, I would much rather have been saved from the time of being a little child than to have rebelled against God and didn't get saved until I was 30 or whatever. Because I went through so much agony in my life. There are so many consequences I'm still dealing with that could have been avoided if only I'd served Jesus from the youngest age. So there's joy in leading children. There's joy in hearing Ethan say, I'm ready to go. There's joy in ministering to others who are struggling. Some of these folks from Blue that are struggling with depression or with anger issues or just a lot of different things. They reveal a lot of problems that they're struggling with. So it should be a joy to be able to share what we have discovered ourselves. The love of Jesus. The salvation of Jesus. The help of Jesus. So, yes, it is a duty, but it's also a joy. And maybe they need to be able to include that in their sign. See, that's the nice thing about digital signs. I mean, is it just, well, let's put joy on here too. No problem. There's definitely upside. I like that digital sign. It's really
Amen.
Nice. And it was kind of funny. A couple of weeks ago, again, we were having breakfast at Sicily's, and the server who always waits on us, and I told her name, Brooke. She said, I saw your picture. You're Don Parmalee. It's like, because I come by this sign. She lives right here in the Overlook apartment. So she saw my picture on the sign. I know him. I wait on him on Tuesday. So... Sorry about that. I would have a hard time because she goes to the church that her husband's uncle pastors in Hayesville. So,
it doesn't matter. She's in church.
That's right. I'm not going to proselytize her in Lake State. She's in church. So, does that answer your question, Cheryl, about a sequence of nine?
Yeah. Okay. Just, again.
TMI.
Well, she knew what the answer was.
Oh, she's right. She's just
making
sure everybody
else knew. Yeah, good. It was good. Advocate sometimes.
Oh, yeah. Well, I appreciate that. It helped me remember I need to explain a little bit more. So, those who are in Christ will go to be with Him. And we look at how fast this will be as we compare verse 14 with 1 Corinthians 15, 51 through 53. Somebody has that.
Behold, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For this perishable must put on imperishable, and this mortal must put on immortality.
So I'm going to get to use this to Cheryl.
Oh.
You got the scripture just before that.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No. I mean, you did right. I mean, she's just a little confused because I was referring to 1 Corinthians 15 twice. So we have it here. This is what Sandra reads. And we're going to go here where we have a little bit more understanding.
And just something cute. Any of you have ever been to a nursery, church nursery, that had that scripture on the wall? We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed on the church nursery wall.
Yep. We will not all sleep, the babies, but we will all be changed. I'm sure maybe multiple times. Depends on how long the preacher preaches. So anyway, we are looking to that resurrection body. And even the Holy Spirit within us is yearning for that. Somebody has Romans 8, 23 through 25.
Not only that, but we also who have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, eagerly waiting for the adoption, the redemption of our body. For we were saved in this hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For why does one still hope for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we eagerly wait for it with perseverance.
So again, we have that word hope. And so I'm reiterating here in Romans 8, 23 through 25, the Holy Spirit has put within us a hope. And we're groaning for the realization of that hope, which is redemption, the resurrection of our bodies. And part of the Holy Spirit drawing to us to Jesus was that assurance. This world is not all there is. The Holy Spirit just kind of wrote it in our heart when we were surrendering, this world is not all there is. There's something better yet to come.
Oh, if you don't mind, I was going to read the NLT version. It has a little parentheses around the 24. I love the way it says it in there. It says, starting at verse 24, we were given this hope when we were saved. And then in parentheses, it says, if we already have something, we don't need hope for it. If we look forward to something we don't yet have, we must wait patiently and confidently.
Right.
I mean, yeah, if you already have it, you don't need hope for it.
That's right. When we get saved, when we repent of our sins and surrender our lives to Jesus, we don't instantly go to heaven. How many of us wish that that's the way it worked? And how many of us wish that's the way it worked with some of our relatives that didn't stay true to Jesus? It was weird. We had before I went into ministry, we had a preacher that said, "You know, if I did it the way I want to do it, I'd get somebody saved and then I'd shoot them in the head and kill them." Then I wouldn't have to worry about. He was kidding, of course, but he was a little blunt and harsh. But anyway, I don't think he would actually do it. He as a pastor, and I, you know, 40 years later, have seen the same things. How many times have we seen somebody go to the altar, cry a pool of tears, get up, and continue to live just as they did before they went to the altar? And that is heartbreaking. because we want everyone to be saved and ready for meeting with Jesus. You know, I'm talking a lot about going to meet him in the air, but if that doesn't happen, you know, we're one heartbeat away from eternity. If you read the paper this week, you saw that. Okay, I encourage you to read the... That was one, but no, another one, it happened at the school. Yes. So pray for those school children that witnessed that. I mean, he went to step out and his heart stopped. That was all she wrote. And so we have to be ready, because we don't know when our heart's going to stop. We don't have any guarantee of the next heartbeat or next breath. So we need to always be ready to step out of hope into the actuality of being in the presence of the Lord. So as we think about this promise of life after death, how might it help us to promote self-examination? As you can see on the handout on question number 4, I'll get there in a minute. Somebody has Hebrews 9, 27 through 28.
And just as each person is destined to die once, and after that comes judgment, so also Christ was offered once for all time as a sacrifice to take away the sins of many people. He will come again, not to deal with our sins, but to bring salvation to all who are eagerly waiting for him.
He's coming to all those who eagerly are waiting for him. And I pray that that describes all of us. But it says very clearly, it's appointed for us to die, and after this comes judgment. But Jesus died to bear the sins of many. And so the realization that we're going to die should help us to examine our lives. Somebody also has a kind of a continuing thought in Hebrews 10, 23 through 31.
Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works, not forsaking the assembly of ourselves together, as in the manner of some, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. For if we sin willfully after we have received the knowledge of the truth, there is no longer remains a sacrifice for sins, but a certain fearful expectation of judgment and fiery indignation which will devour the adversary. Anyone who has rejected Moses' law dies without mercy on the testimony of two or three witnesses. Of how much worse punishment do you suppose will he be thought worthy, who has trampled the Son of God underfoot, counted the blood of the covenant by which he was sanctified a common thing, and insulted the Spirit of grace? For we know him who said, vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. And again, the Lord will judge his people. It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God.
For anyone who's outside a relationship with Jesus, verse 31, is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. With the Lord's help and the anointing of the Holy Spirit, we need to share with people judgment is coming. And it's going to resonate with them, because I believe that what it's saying in verse 27, they already, if they're outside of relationship with Jesus, there is a certain fearful looking of judgment and fiery indignation. As the writer of Hebrews is saying, it was bad for those who died under the Mosaic covenant, under the Mosaic law. But for those who have received the grace of God, who have been washed by the blood, it says, of how much worse punishment if we reject that. So may we continually look at our lives and make sure that we are ready to be with Jesus, to go into eternity, to face judgment. So I hope these scriptures speak to you about that. Now, as the Apostle Paul is speaking to us, he says in 1 Thessalonians 4, 15, that he is speaking by an authority. He says, for this we say to you, Thessalonians, I'm writing this to you by the word of the Lord. And then he says what's going to happen. So he says his authority is the word of the Lord. So he is writing as an apostle of the Lord Jesus Christ. He is writing as a Pharisee who has deep knowledge of the Old Covenant. And as he looked at the Old Covenant, he understood what Jesus was saying in the light of that, that it was a fulfillment. Somebody has Daniel 12, 2 through 3. Somebody has that. Daniel 12, 2 and 3.
And many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, and some to shame and everlasting contempt. And they that be wise shall shine as brightness of the firmament, and they that turn men to righteousness as the stars forever.
So in Daniel, there's the prophecy that those who sleep in the dust of the ground, those who have died, they're going to awake. Some are going to awake to everlasting life. Others are going to be awakened to reproach and everlasting contempt. So Paul had in mind something like what we're seeing there in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. But the Holy Spirit gave him even greater understanding of this event that was to come. That these that awake to the glory of the Lord, who awake to everlasting life, that the Lord is going to have a special event that is going to be announced, and they are going to be with him if they are in Christ, if they have accepted Messiah. So, as we said, we don't believe in soul sleep. We believe that those who have died are with the Lord. We believe that they have purpose, they have experiences. For instance, somebody has Matthew 17:3.
Then they looked and saw Moses and Elijah speaking with him.
So Moses and Elijah were not asleep in the ground somewhere. They were with God. And Jesus had a meeting with them while he walked the earth in Matthew 17. We call it the Mount of Transfiguration. Jesus was transfigured before the disciples. He shone as bright as the sun, and he was meeting with Moses and Elijah, two very prominent individuals from the Old Covenant. So they weren't sleeping somewhere in the ground. They were doing what God had them to do, in this case, is meeting with Jesus. We hear also what the Apostle Paul says in 2 Corinthians 5:6-9. Somebody has that. 2 Corinthians 5:6-9.
That's why we're always full of courage. Even while we're at home in the body, we're homesick to be with the Master. For we live by faith, not by what we see with our eyes. We live with a joyful confidence, yet at the same time we take delight in the thought of leaving our bodies behind to be at home with the Lord. So whether we live or die, we make it our life's passion to live our lives pleasing to Him.
To be home in the body, to be where everybody here is right this moment, is to be absent from the presence of the Lord. We're not standing in His presence, we're in the body. But if we leave the body, it says to be absent from the body is to be at home with the Lord, to be in His presence. You know, so the Apostle Paul is writing a little bit later in his life and saying, you know, I prefer to be absent from the body and be home with the Lord, but my passion, I like the way the New Living Translation says, my passion is to be pleasing to God. Whether I'm here or whether I'm with Him, doesn't matter. My passion is to be pleasing to God. May we have that testimony that we are pleasing to God. And then maybe some of the Thessalonians were having a little bit of trouble understanding what happens, you know, when we're raised from the dead, or what happens when we're translated from this world into this glorified body. What does that all look like? And this is a long passage. I gave it to Sister Cheryl to read. If you want to look at it, write the reference down. This 1 Corinthians 15:35-50. But Sister Cheryl, if you don't mind reading that, we'll talk about it in a minute.
But someone will ask, how are the dead raised? With what kind of body will they come? How foolish. What you sow does not come to life unless it dies. When you sow, you do not plant the body that will be, but just a seed, perhaps of wheat or of something else. But God gives it a body as he has determined. And to each kind of seed, he gives its own body. Not all flesh is the same. People have one kind of flesh, animals have another, birds another, and fish another. There are also heavenly bodies, and there are earthly bodies. But the splendor of the heavenly bodies is one kind, and the splendor of the earthly bodies is another. The sun has one kind of splendor, the moon another, and the stars another. And star differs from star in splendor. So will it be with the resurrection of the dead? The body that is sown is perishable. It is raised imperishable. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. It is sown a natural body. It is raised a spiritual body. If there is a natural body, there is also a spiritual body. So it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam, a life-giving spirit. The spiritual did not come first, but the natural, and after that, the spiritual. The first man was of the dust of the earth. The second man is of heaven. As was the earthly man, so are those who are of the earth. And as is the heavenly man, so also are those who are of heaven. And just as we have borne the image of the earthly man, so shall we bear the image of the heavenly man. I declare to you, brothers and sisters, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we'll all be changed. Amen. In a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed.
So, if you were reading along, you have it in front of you, or if you were listening, what are some aspects of our body that we're looking toward in the future?
A new body.
Yes. Okay.
And it's a spiritual body.
It's a spiritual body.
Yes.
Imperishable.
Do what?
It's imperishable.
Imperishable.
You don't have to get parts of it.
That's it. Sorry.
A good one, born in the image of God.
That's right, absolutely. Anybody else? It's going to be different.
That would be the same.
As different as a seed of wheat is from a wheat plant. There's a lot of difference between a seed and a wheat plant.
Okay, so question about that, because again, a while ago we were just discussing that, you know, as far as in the transfiguration was concerned, that when Moses, you know, showed up, they noticed that it was Moses.
Right.
And Elijah was Elijah.
They knew that, having never met them.
Right, exactly. And so, of course, the look, okay, I mean, to me, to know that it's Moses and Elijah, either one, the Holy Spirit informed them that that was like Moses and Elijah, because they must not have looked like, you know, their previous bodies.
They probably smelled like it.
Did they? Yeah. So how is it that they really knew that that was Moses and Elijah? You know, if they didn't look like Moses and Elijah. Because we're supposed to be getting a new body, spiritual
right.
body.
The word also says we'll be known as we are known.
Exactly.
Right.
So.
Right. Just like you know a sheaf of wheat.
Right.
Even from a seed, because you've seen both.
Right.
Somehow we're going to know each other.
Right.
And it's very clear that there is a uniqueness to every one of us.
Yes.
And that uniqueness, even though we're going to be tremendously different, is still apparent even in a glorified body. Now, Moses and Elijah had not yet received their glorified bodies. We're going more into the weeds to a way. We believe that when Jesus died, he went into the underworld. He went into Hades, Sheol, whatever you want to call it. And he set the captives free. He, as it says in Ephesians chapter 4, he took captivity captive. We believe that he brought all of those Old Testament saints, all those who had lived under the Mosaic covenant, that he took them to be with him, with those who now die in Christ. And so that when that trumpet sounds, and we've got the trumpet sounding, that's important because, Sunday I'm going to be preaching on Feast of Trumpets. So when that trumpet sounds, Moses and the rest of them also are going to have to be reunited with a glorified body. So even in their spirit form, they were known. Did they have a balloon over their head, said, this is Moses, this is Elijah? I don't know how they knew. Did the Holy Spirit tell them? Somehow they knew. But as Sister Carol said, we will know even as we are known. And I believe that's in 1 Corinthians 13, if I remember correctly. In the same way, we're going to know who David is when we get to be with him. We're going to know who Moses is and Elijah and our husbands, our wives, our children. We're going to know them all. I can't tell you exactly how because, again, the difference is going to be like the difference of a seed and a plant.
They're going to wear a name tag.
Absolutely. Everybody got
name tags.
And they're not going to fall off like the ones do now.
You know, the word says that eye has not seen nor ear heard.
That's right.
What he has. So all these imaginative things that you can think of, you're not going to get anywhere near.
No.
There he is. But he's got everything already worked out. Because I look too much forward to seeing my mom and my grandmother. And I've got little babies that I had miscarriage. They're in heaven. I'll get to see them. So, he doesn't say that we have to know everything.
That's right.
He's saving some surprises.
I can only imagine.
I believe that even when we are in the presence of the Lord, we are not going to be God. We are not going to know everything. And there's still going to be a whole lot to learn. Heaven is going to be a learning experience. 10,000 years, and we will have only just begun in learning about who God is, and about how great he is, and about how deep his love is. As Sister, and you may want to write this down because it's a really good scripture that Sister Barbara mentioned. It's in 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse number 9. Just as it is written, things which eye has not seen and ear has not heard and which have not entered into the heart of man, all that God has prepared for those who love him. Again, that's 1 Corinthians. I'm sorry to get up there. This came out of the blue, obviously. 1 Corinthians 2 and verse number 9. And maybe I should include 10. For to us, verse 10, God revealed them through the Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things, even the depths of God. But still, we're limited in this fleshly form to understand everything about God. So there's so many things that we can't even conceive of that He's going to reveal to us, that are going to be so splendorous, as the translation Sister Cheryl was reading talked about. It's going to be splendorous that the body that is sown in weakness is going to be raised in power. The body that was, that broke down and breaks down, corruptible, is going to become imperishable. There's so many things we learn here about what happens at the resurrection. And so I encourage us to dig down into those, because there's so much there. Again, we're not going to understand all of this fully because we're just not capable of this. But we're going to have a tremendous experience of this new body that does not deteriorate, decay, or perish. It's not subject to death any longer. No more humiliation, no more weakness. It may be sown, it may die and go into the earth, or whatever way your remains are taken care of, but it will be raised in spiritual magnificence, resurrection magnificence. So it's not that we're going to be unreal, filmy, or ghostly. We're not going to be a bunch of ghosts, but we're going to have substance just like Jesus had whenever He was raised to life after His death. And this is a scripture I love. I've loved it ever since I got saved. Somebody read it for me. 1 John 3:1-2.
See how very much our Father loves us, for He calls us His children. And that is what we are. But the people who belong to this world don't recognize that we are God's children, because they do not know Him. Dear friends, we are already God's children, but He has not yet shown us what we will be like when Christ appears. But we do know that we will be like Him, for we will see Him as He really is.
Goes right along with what Sister Barbara said from 1 Corinthians 2. We are children of God. It has not been manifested as yet what we will be. But we know that when He is manifested, we will be like Him. When He appears in the clouds, whenever that trumpet sounds, whenever the shout of the archangel happens, we will be like Him, because we will see Him as He is. Man, I love that. How great a love the Father has given to us. Woo! That one is a good one to end on. So think about that one again. That's 1 John 3:1-2. If you had these scriptures, if you'll just leave them laying on the table, we'll continue on from here next week. As I said, you can see this is a deep subject with a lot of jumping off points. And if you have questions, please write them down and feel free to ask them, okay? Because I want us to be clear on this. Let's pray. Father, I thank You for the glorious time that we've had in the scriptures tonight. Lord, thinking about eternity. Lord, what I put on the mantle yesterday, that we keep our attention on the things of heaven, not on the things of the earth. Lord, we're anticipating being with You. We're anticipating things that are greater than our imagination can even begin to touch. And we live in a day when computer graphics and everything just shows us things that our forefathers could never have imagined. And yet, it's going to be even greater than that. Greater than CGI effects in movies. It's going to be greater than all of humanity has capability of imagining. And we look forward to that. Lord, I pray that as we leave this place, we leave here in hope, that confident expectation of something that is absolutely certain, and that, Lord, we live here determined that we're going to share this news with someone else. We don't want to see them miss out on what You have for them. And Father, I thank you and praise you for doing it. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thanks for being here tonight. Appreciate it. God bless.